Hello everyone, CANNONLOWY here, this time with Bendy and the Ink Machine, and I'm going to look over what I liked about Bendy and the Ink Machine, and also some things that I thought could have been done better. So here is my review of Bendy and the Ink Machine. Firstly, Bendy and the Ink Machine was first made in the early 2017 by TheMeatlyGames, or now known as Kindly Beast, and it was released in chapters, chapter 1 through 5, and the final chapter was just recently released on October 26th of 2018, if I recall correctly. So, without further ado, let's get started. So when you first start the game, you get to hear that you are playing as Henry, who is visiting an old pal's workshop by the name of Joey Drew. Joey Drew has made quite a name for himself at one point, and he has had some very curious things happen to his workshop. So as Henry, you get to explore what has happened after the 30 years that Henry decided to step away from the studio.
All right, Joey. I'm here. Let's see if we can find what you wanted me to see.
So initially, starting the game, it doesn't really tell you what the overall goal is with this adventure. You're left to explore the world, and as you can see here, the whole entire landscape is filled with a very old animation style of roughly the 1920s and 30s. And that is, for me, that is really what this game's charm is. It really is what makes this game stand out to me. And as you can see here, there is posters all around of the title character, Bendy, but also these supporting characters like Boris the Wolf, and later on, Alice Angel, and possibly a few others. So, initially starting out, it just says, find Joey's secret. And you're just kind of left to your own devices here, with the whole workshop seemingly abandoned for one reason or another, ink kind of flowing everywhere for an unexplained reason, and writing on the walls, such as dreams come true. So at the start, it kind of leads you one way or another to this ink machine, though. So even though that it doesn't really tell you exactly what you're looking for, it is pretty easy to find.
This lift could use a few dry cells.
It is usually pretty simple to find what you're looking for. I personally did get lost a few times in chapter one because I thought it was just the right size to get lost in, but I think that's more of a personal thing than for the average player. So gameplay-wise, what does Bendy and the Ink Machine kind of play like? Well, you're exploring the world, definitely, as Henry, and you're finding various puzzle pieces. For an example here, we find two dry cells to raise the mysterious ink machine.
Let's see what you're hiding down there, old friend.
So just like any sane man, Henry decides to turn on the ink machine to find out what Joey Drew was doing with it. Throughout this story, you do find several different characters that you can interact with, usually. and they have influence to several game mechanics. Usually, every chapter has a character that they focus on, and also kind of gives their own theme and very unique personalities. Throughout this story, for most of the puzzles, it just is a matter of looking for a certain item that you need to activate something to progress, like a switch, or like right here for the initial starting of the ink machine, you need several different items. For anything that you interact with, it usually glows a little bit like this. And then you can pick it up using the E key. For the most part, the controls are pretty similar to pretty much any first-person shooter or first-person adventure game, like the Stanley Parable, if that is relatable. Also, for this, the punching in machine is how you save.
Punching in.
Usually the game auto-saves whenever you pick up an item, but if you are in the middle of a task and you want to save and you know that it hasn't auto-saved for a while, punching in might just save you your job. Throughout Bendy and the Ink Machine, how it plays its story is very interesting. And instead of being directly told to you by characters or cutscenes, it chooses to use these old audio logs that you can interact with.
At this point, I don't get what Joey's plan is for this company. The animations sure aren't being finished on time anymore, and I simply don't see why we need this machine. It's noisy, it's messy, and who needs that much ink anyway? Also, get this.
So instead of, like I said, instead of using cutscenes necessarily to tell its story, largely of how you find out what has happened over the course of those 30 years that Henry has been gone is by using those audio logs to learn what these various characters have said to reacting to the ink machine being put in the studio, as well as various other things. For an example, Alice Angel being a, well, pretty much every character in this game is more or less a major character. The character for who voiced Alice Angel, Susie Campbell, she has audio logs talking about her job as being a voice actress, for an example. Wally Franks being mostly a handyman, or Thomas Connor is also a handyman. They talk about their job being a handyman around the studio. So that is mostly how it tells its story, but it's not limited to that. So it's definitely an interesting take, I will say, and I do like it actually. I'd say it's different enough that I like it. But at the same time, like, if you already know the story, for an example, or anything, you can also skip over them. But it also creates the possibility of anyone who is playing this for the first time to not actually see all of the audio logs, so they might miss out on parts of the story. So how much you get from the story is pretty much reliant on how many audio logs you find and interact with. So, there is pluses and minuses to that way of storytelling. As you progress through the deserted music studio, you will find various different tools to help you progress. For an example, I have here is an axe that can help me break through any boards that go in my path. But it's not just for utility purposes. You will have to actually fight enemies in Bendy and the Machine, or at least if you don't want to fight them, well, actually there are parts that you actually do need to kill the enemy in question in order to progress, but sometimes you can avoid them by just running away. And here is the basic enemy that you will The first enemy that you will be fighting, the searcher enemy. And the anchor on your screen is based on is how much health you have. So, obviously, the more inky it is, the lower your health is. Unfortunately, the combat in this game is actually my least favorite aspect of the entire game, and it's mostly down to Henry's movement speed, and it basically his base movement speed without you sprinting, holding down the shift button, is very slow, and you can't actually sprint backwards. So fighting enemies, especially ones, most of the enemies in this game are either roughly about the same speed as how Henry moves normally, and they also tend to have either the same range or longer range than Henry's weapons do. So it just feels, I don't know if unfair is the right word, but it doesn't really work the best, and that's pretty much my main negative point, is primarily the combat in this game. While I do like some of the puzzles, and there are some that I don't like as well, but I find that the world and exploring is a whole lot more enjoyable than the combat aspect. And I kind of think that one thing that could have helped that is allowing Henry to sprint backwards. So there's that. And I think we're coming up to a puzzle here. So in the music department, there is a puzzle that I quite like, and it involves the various instruments. And basically, you get an audio log that tells you to press, activate these different instruments in the right order to unlock this door to a valve that drains the stairwell. And that's one of the more unique puzzles, in my opinion, and I thought that it was really well done. But there is at least one or two puzzles in here that I didn't really like either. So we'll skip to when I get to that. All right, now we're coming up to the puzzle in question here.
What is that thing holding my valve?
So this searcher here with the construction hat, he has a valve that we need to remove the ink. And honestly, I guess in some ways you might not even think of this calling this a puzzle. So basically what happens is that when you get close to him, he moves to another spot and you can't actually get to him. Well, I mean you can, but you can't actually do anything to get the valve back. So what you need to do is chase him until he spawns right underneath that, and he actually, of course, now that I'm putting this up, he spawns right in the right location. So basically you have to chase him around until he goes to the spot where you can smash him like that. And there were some instances where when I played through the game where I had to spend around 5 minutes or so chasing the searcher around until he finally got into the right spot for him, for you to be able to send the cargo down and smash him. So that is an example of one of the puzzles that I didn't really care for. So the puzzles, in my opinion, for the most part, they're pretty good, but there are a few that I didn't really care for, mostly because of RNG being involved, like this one. So that is an example of that. So throughout exploring the studio, you will encounter Bendy, and what he does is that he has this inky aura that he encases the world with, and in these miracle stations, these outhouses, if you want to call them that, you can hide from all enemies, and that's the only way to avoid Bendy. If he notices you, he runs at you, and if he even so much as touches you, you instantly get killed. So he is the main enemy that you will face throughout the game, or at least theoretically. Bendy and the Ink Machine, definitely, I will say that the main feature that I really thought was well done about this game was its atmosphere for the horror aspect. The atmosphere, I thought, was brilliantly done, and that was one of the things that not only I appreciated, but I really loved about when you were exploring the abandoned studio. The type of horror that, if I ever do play a horror game, is the atmosphere. Was it nailed down and giving you a sense of anything could happen, and the tenseness? And I love that a lot more than jump scares. A lot of horror games, it seems like, especially these days, rely too much on things jumping at you, and this game does have jump scares, especially in Chapter 4, unfortunately, but I feel like they did a good job on having the jump scares mostly taking a back seat instead of always having jump scares, and that's the type of horror that I do like. The two main horror games that I've played before this one was Silent Hill 2 and 3, and I definitely enjoyed Silent Hill 2 more than 3, but both of them have very good horrifying atmosphere rather than just having terrifying enemies. This game does have very good terrifying monster designs, but the atmosphere leading up to encounters with those enemies is definitely what was brilliantly done about this game. Alright, now I'm going to mention the scare factor of this game. Naturally, for a game that is classified as a horror game, it is kind of important for a horror game to be scary, or at least I would think so. So this game, while I was playing through it with my Let's Play, the problem that I had was that I had watched a Let's Play of the first four chapters of this game. This game has five total chapters, or six if you count the archives as a chapter, but that's not really story related. So naturally, I didn't really get scared for the most part, from the content from chapter 1 through 4, and especially for chapter 4, I just didn't really feel terrified at all. But the thing is that even when I played chapter 5 completely blind, because it had just come out, and I had tried to record and upload it the day that chapter 5 came out in October of last year, I honestly didn't really feel that scared of anything that I encountered. The only time that I really felt terrified or really tense of the situation that I was in was in the areas that Bendy, the Ink Demon himself, could spawn. And I think the main thing that really got to me was the fact that Bendy could appear at any time while you were doing these tasks for Alice in order to get out of the studio, that you have to spend a lot of time doing these various things. Like, one of them is turning valves in order to get these power cells or something, and various things that leave you out in the open for extended periods of time. And that was pretty much the only time that I really felt tense and worried and and just waiting for Bendy and his aura to show up at any time, that was pretty much the only time that when I was playing the game, even when I was playing Chapter 5 Blind, that was pretty much the only time that I really felt scared. So I would definitely say this. I haven't really played very many horror games, so if that has any impact on this, I'm usually not very much into horror games. I have played very few of them. Like, the number of horror games that I've played probably don't even come up to the fingers on my hands. But that was pretty much the only time where I really felt tense. So I would say definitely this game has things that I can definitely appreciate that I could find players who play the whole entire game blind to feel tense or terrified to a degree, but I would definitely say this game isn't as scary as definitely other games out there. Some final thoughts about Bendy and the Ink Machine as a whole is that, for the most part, there are definitely things that I can really appreciate that they have done really well. And I think if I did play the first four chapters blind, I think I would have probably gotten tense or scared too, probably not to the extent of when Bendy shows up, but at least enough to make note of it. So in watching those Let's Plays of the first four chapters kind of ruined the beginning experience for me. So anyone who's watching this review, if you are even remotely interested in this game, I would definitely recommend playing this completely blind if you can. And I'm not sure if this is still the case, but when I was first getting into Bendy and the Ink Machine, the first chapter was actually free. You could get it on Steam for free. Now, since the game now has their whole complete edition that has all five chapters in one, I'm not exactly sure if that is still the case now, but if it is, try out the first chapter if it's available for free and see what you think of it. I mean, the first chapter is definitely not super eventful, but it gives you an idea of at least somewhat what to expect in the other chapters. The first chapter, well, it doesn't have any really difficult things in it, I will say. I'm doing my best to try not to spoil anything that I think would impact the experience. So definitely try out this game if the first chapter is still available for free. Just try it out and see what you think of it. I would say I definitely enjoyed the world building of this game a lot more than the combat or some of the puzzles. I enjoy the world of being like in a cartoon and seeing the various characters and their personalities and the characters that of the inky creations like Alice Angel and Boris, seeing those characters, how they interact and everything. I definitely enjoyed that a lot more than especially the combat. Now, what I will say though, it is really strange to me, is that it almost feels like the boss battles in certain points in the game kind of keep Henry's movement speed in mind more than the normal enemies. I mean, that's kind of sad to say, but that's how I felt. I felt that boss battles were a lot more fair than the normal enemy encounters. So, if that says anything, but I will say that Chapter 5, for because of the events in Chapter 5, they actually made combat a lot more manageable. And also, Chapter 4 also had a lot better mechanics as well. So, if that means anything, hopefully that... I don't think that could be considered a spoiler. So that's kind of how I felt about this game. I mean, there are definitely things that I can really appreciate. And I really love the world building and the characters. And the aspect of exploration rather than some of the other aspects. So now it's time to... How would I rate this game? And kind of a tough decision on me, because on one hand I have played games that I would consider better, but at the same time there are also games, I mean this game, that there's a lot of things that I can appreciate. And also, for anyone who doesn't know, this game was actually made by a relatively small team as well. So considering what they've made with a small team, and what I really appreciate about this game, but also keeping account the things that I didn't like about the game, I would rate this game as a solid, very good rating. Now, if you are new to my channel or haven't seen any of my previous reviews, which at this point I only have one other review, so that wouldn't be surprising, my rating system will be in the video description. Also, I forgot to mention that also this, so something that personally I really appreciated about this game, despite it being a horror game, it didn't really have any language. This is my personal preference, but it seems like a lot of horror games have a lot of language in it. Well, this game didn't really have any from what I remember, so that is something that I definitely appreciated and really thought was great about this game. So with that, thank you very much for watching. Hopefully this review has been helpful to you in deciding whether or not to invest in Bendy and the Ink Machine. And to my best of abilities, hopefully I haven't had any major spoilers for you to ruin your experience. So thank you very much for watching, and have a wonderful day.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.